Thank you for watching today's message. Today, we're going to bring to you a testimony like possibly none you've ever heard before. Jim Masterfield, who was Mr. America many years ago, is going to share about his life in bodybuilding, his life in powerlifting, and how God rearranged the priorities, the ego in his life. And so you're going to see a little bit of a pre-message from me and then a testimony from Jim Masterfield that I will tell you is not only heartwarming, it is life-changing. And there wasn't a dry eye in the house as he begins to share his testimony. I want to take you into the message from Jim Masterfield and myself as we share about the love of Jesus Christ and the importance to know him intimately.
How many know that tomorrow is not guaranteed? In fact, nothing about tomorrow is guaranteed. That we stand not only wondering what tomorrow holds, we stand submitted that tomorrow could bring anything. We have a wonderful member of our church who, she's a mother, took care of her children, took care of her husband, was a real resourceful, wonderful lady, beautiful wife, in a moment's time had a stroke and left her not able to feed herself, not able to speak, not able to function. And many of you have met her and know her, and God's changing and things have been changing and getting better for her. But she didn't know that one day she would be one way and the next day everything changed. She thought everything was secure. She thought that the provision was hers. And so often we think we provide for ourselves, but the truth is God is our provider. That all the things we think we can do to make it happen ultimately result in God makes it happen. Matthew 6:31 says, "Therefore, do not worry, saying, 'What shall I eat, or what shall I drink, or what shall I wear?' For after all these things the Gentiles seek, for your heavenly Father knows that you have need," or need all these things. See, it's not that you don't have a need for these things, it's they're important. "But seek first the kingdom of God." This is the part we miss. It's not that God doesn't want to give us. He wants to bless his people, but he won't bless us. He can't bless us. His hands are tied in blessing us if we don't seek him first. If we put those things first, then you limit God's ability to work in your life. "But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness," standing right with him, standing right with him and man. Seek first the righteousness of God, and then all these things will be added unto you. What things? What you shall eat, what you shall drink, what shall you wear, what's your provision? And they'll be sufficient for the day and its own trouble. Meaning that let's not worry about tomorrow because it's going to have trouble. Because today's got plenty of trouble, but with plenty of trouble comes plenty of grace. But when we get caught up in worrying about tomorrow and all the trouble, then we stop God from being able to work on today. I'm not saying that you shouldn't have a five-year plan. I'm not saying you shouldn't have a 401k. I'm not saying any of that. You know, I live my life. I wouldn't even tell people to live the life that I live. I'm all in, all the time. I'm just all in. But I want to tell you something. I will say this, that one thing we all should do is know that we deal with today, we trust God today, and we keep our thoughts and our worry and our strife and our trouble and our fighting away from tomorrow. We trust God today. We have faith for today. And here's the thing. If we're led by the Spirit every day, if today we're faithful with today, if today we're faithful with what we have, if today we're led by the Spirit today, God does know what tomorrow holds. And he'll allow us to set today that'll make tomorrow work out for good. But when we only care about ourselves and our ego and our troubles and our problems and our success today, and it's all about us, and we don't put God's kingdom first, what happens is tomorrow begins to crumble. And then we find ourselves in a crumbling tomorrow, and what do we do? God, where are you? And he says, I've been there every day before now, and you wouldn't listen to me. So now I'm going to walk you through trouble. But trouble can be difficult to get through. James 4:13 says this, come now, you who say today or tomorrow, we'll go and do such thing in this city, spend a year, buy, sell, make a profit, whereas you do not know what will happen tomorrow. For what is your life? It is even a vapor that appears for a little time and then vanishes away. Instead, you ought to say, if the Lord wills, you shall live and do this and do that. But now you boast in your arrogance. All such boasting is evil. What is he saying? He's saying, listen, for me to say this is my plan and I'm doing this without saying, God, everything is submitted to your will. All that I am, all that I have is submitted to your will, to your best. He says, if you don't do that, I consider it evil. It goes on to say, therefore, to him who knows to do good and does it not, it is sin. He's saying, not only do I consider it to be evil, I consider it to be sin, which means to miss the mark, miss God's best for your life. How do you miss God's best for your life? Simply to have the arrogance to make plans without putting God first. The greatest arrogance of all is to say, God, I can do it on my own. I don't need your blessing. I can do it my way, God, because your way is not going to be good enough and it's too hard. It's not needed. What arrogance. Every day is a gift from God. You realize that as your life comes to an end. See, I'm the one that gets to meet the street corner with a person dying, the riverside with a drowned victim, the hospital, emergency room, the hospital bed. You know, I can take my three-year-old son and we can go to the hospital and he says, is this where Grandpa died? Or can I go to Grandpa's room and see him? Both his grandpas and his grandma in the last 2 years have all died in that hospital. Folks, when you get down to the last of your life, you start to listen. Here's the problem. We listen when we're in trouble and we forget so quickly. We listen and we want God to move in our lives. But when we prosper, we forget God. Woe to the one who prospers and forgets from where he came. Whether that be in health, or finances, or life. Woe to the one who prospers and forgets from where he came. See, it's easy. We actually do better serving God without than with. Some of you are going, I don't know why God's not prospering me. Well, he loves you. And you don't have the integrity to prosper. But you know what? He's wanting to prosper you. He loves you. He wants you to prosper. So what he wants to do is he's pacing it out by teaching you to be faithful with a little so you can be faithful over kingdoms, so you can have great things, but not until you realize who's in charge. You know, if you go back to 9/11, what happened after 9/11, the country literally turned to God. I mean, there was a revival. The churches were full. And within a short time, we were not fearful any longer. The world wasn't coming to an end. And we were back doing our own thing. Yeah, there's some of you faithful, but so many had forgotten God again. Some, losing their houses, run to God. But once they get their housing figured out, church is just too much of a pain, and God doesn't need to be... Their devotion life starts to cease. Their children are doing good. When children start to hurt, guess what? We run back going, oh, am I in trouble? Folks, the answer isn't to not run to God in trouble. The answer is to learn from your trouble. So in your success, it's not about you. It's about God. That when you find yourself having, it's all dedicated to God. And seek ye first the kingdom of God, so he can add the rest to you. I have an incredible friend I call him a friend. I've only known him for a very short time. I call him a friend because, honestly, in a very short matter of moments, if you know Jim and his wife, you will know that they are a couple that loves God. And his heart, I said this in first service, I want to be the kind of man he is. I want to believe that if I face the things and success and also the storms of life, that I would want to face it the way he's facing it. Nothing is more important than people knowing God.
Coming to you from backstage at the 1994 NPC Masters National Championships, this is Carl Morelli for Video Action, and we're very happy to be interviewing tonight heavyweight competitor Jim Masterfield. Jim, thank you for coming before our Video Action cameras. How do you feel in the contest this evening?
Nervous, but relaxed that the prejudging's over.
Was the prejudging the hardest part of the contest?
Yeah, there's a lot of beef out there, a lot of beef in this nation that you don't realize that exists because you're isolated in your own little area.
Well, we've noticed over the last few years that the Masters competition seems to be getting more and more really terrific competitors every year. Why do you think this is the case?
I think just the health attitude that people have. People are starting to be concerned about their quality of life.
And you think they want to stay healthier longer and just preserve the obviously good physiques that they've built up over the years?
Oh, you bet. I think it's worthwhile. The quality of life that I have is important to me. It may not give me longevity of life, but at least the quality is better.
Well, speaking of quality, I mean, there's a difference between maintaining a healthy and a fit body and being a bodybuilding competitor. Obviously, you've taken it to a higher level. What prods you on to do that?
I love competition. I love to compete. I used to compete in powerlifting, and I did very well in that for a number of years. And it's not the healthiest sport in the world because of the heavy weight that you handle and because you're not really, your body fat's up a little bit more than what is with bodybuilding. So when I got a little bit older, I decided I wanted just to cut some of the fat and be healthier.
Now, for bodybuilders, it's always a great sacrifice to get ready for a contest. The dieting, the fact that you have to lead your life in other pursuits, but you then have to get it together to be in a show, and there are pressures involved. You're at an age where most people probably have forgotten about competition. You're still engaged in it. And are there special difficulties because you've done it in the past and now you're continuing because this diet routine is so tough?
I think the time that it takes away from family, you know, my kids, they understand and they're very supportive, but it does. It takes away time that you would normally spend with them, hitting the gym twice a day or three times a day instead of just once a day, getting it out of the way so you could spend time with them. So there's a lot of adjusting that you have to do in just your personal life with family, and it helps if they're very understanding.
Yeah. How does the family respond? Are they very understanding for this?
Oh, they're very supportive. My kids are fairly young still. I have a teenager and two smaller ones, and they're ready for dad to get out there and go for it.
Speaking of going for it, obviously this is only one part of your life, and you have a full career in bloom here. What do you do when you're not bodybuilding?
Well, I'm a registered physical therapist, and I do home health, which I enjoy thoroughly. I go to people that are homebound that for rehabilitation of strokes, total hips, total knees, MS.
Is that a very satisfying profession, helping people that way?
I love it. I love it.
How long do you intend to continue to compete?
Well, there's an over 60. I hope someday there's an over 70 class, you know. I'll do the over 50 when it comes around. I'll do the over 60 when it comes around.
Well, as some people say, when they stop eating, they'll stop working out.
That's very true.
Right. Jim, thank you very much for speaking with us. We want to wish you the best of luck in the contest this evening.
Thank you.
And we look forward to training with you in the gym tomorrow.
Thanks a lot.
Great. From Fort Lauderdale, Florida, at the 1994 NPC Masters Championships with Jim Masterfield backstage, this is Carl Morelli.
Well, I thank you for the privilege and the honor to be able to share with you my testimony and what the Lord has done for me to get me closer to Him. Well, as you saw in this, that actually was me at one time. And it took a lot of dedication to get there.
took a lot of time to do that. And it was all about my own ego. Well, EGO is not an acronym, but EGO could stand for edging God out. And that's exactly what I was doing. I was edging God out. I had been a Christian since the mid-70s in college. I gave my life to the Lord, at least I thought I did. But actually, I just liked being saved, but the Lordship, no. The Lordship was not part of my lifestyle. So the Lord came second or third or whatever else I was doing at that time. And sometimes I think all of us, we want that, but being Lord, well, what happened over the next few years really changed me. I'm going to say what Max Lucado, in his book, Just Like Jesus, says, that Jesus loves you just the way you are, but he refuses to let you stay that way. And I am so thankful that God didn't let me stay that way. For 24 years, while I was doing things like this for myself and doing the weightlifting, I got third in the world. I wanted a world record, never got it. Had a friend come up a few years later and said, Jim, look where you're at now. I was 166. I had no rating. So it was for ridiculous things that I was doing. I'm not saying weightlifting or bodybuilding is bad, but if you put things before the Lord, he doesn't like that. He wants a relationship with us. And relationships take time. We can't expect to know Jesus Christ if we don't spend time with him. I ended up taking the Masters USA. And after that was done, just a very short time after that, I was looking for something else to help satisfy my ego. I needed to have my ego satisfied. Did I check out further of Jesus Christ? No. 24 years, I was slapping the Lord in the face of my lifestyle and putting him way down. In Hebrews 12:6, it says, He punishes those that he accepts as a son and disciplines those that he loves. And I am so thankful for that. He didn't let me go after all the times that I was treating him so bad. Almighty God, and I was doing that to him. Well, I got closer to the Lord. I started reading my Bible, going to church, and I noticed family got a little better. I noticed things started to make a little bit more sense in that I didn't have to have an ego satisfied in order to be happy. I was pretty stupid at one time as far as thinking that I could actually do that. Well, as I was going along in life, I was working at the hospital, and we were turning our programs that we would write on a patient And we got a new computer system that would make it to where it would go out to all the physicians and to the hospital, to the nurses. Everybody that needed to know was able to be known. And one day I was looking at that. I was looking down at the keys, trying to write something. And I noticed I couldn't see the full word. I thought, what is going on here? Something like fun, F-U-N. And I couldn't see half of the word. And I thought, oh no, I've had a stroke. And so I immediately went in and they scheduled an MRI and went back to the physician. He said, no, Jim, you haven't had a stroke. You've got a huge tumor. And he let me look at it. And it was about as big as my fist inside my head. And it caused a lot of things where it was at. It caused things like I couldn't speak as well as what I used to. I couldn't read. I was as slow as not even a third grader. I had to, thank goodness, they have CDs now. I happened to get that tumor right at the time where our technology allowed me to still be able to communicate. So I listened to the Bible on CD, and it works out wonderful. Not the best, but I praise God for that. Well, I was there after that, and they scheduled a surgery really quick. They wanted to get that tumor out of there. And he said, oh, it's no big thing. It's just a benign tumor, and it's not cancerous. And so I thought, okay, it's fine. Little did I know when he was doing the surgery that when I was under, the surgeon that came in trying to get the tumor out, it had failed. Couldn't stop the bleeding. I lost about a gallon of blood, and that's almost all of it. And he came back out and was crying, the surgeon was, to my pastor. Little did I know any of this, they put me on a helicopter and airlifted me to OHSU. So I went up there, and while I was there, they came in, a couple of neurosurgeons, and said, we are sorry, Mr. Masterfield, but we can't stop the bleeding either, and we can't get all of the tumor, but we're going to make you as comfortable as possible, and essentially, you're going to die. Well, you know, when you're told that you're about to die any minute, any second, whatever, a lot of things come to the forefront of your mind. It wasn't anything to do with weightlifting, bodybuilding. It wasn't anything to do with my degree, with my profession. What it had to do with in my mind was my relationships, my relationship with my church family, my relationship with my children, with my relationship with my wife, but especially my relationship with Jesus Christ. At that moment, he came the closest that I've ever had him at that point. Anyway, little did I know, they did a second surgery because my wife came in and said, honey, we're going to go home in just a few days. And I said, it's all right, honey. It's okay. I know where I'm going. I'm ready to go home. And she goes, no, really? Well, what they had done, a second surgery. And they were able to stop the bleeding. They didn't get all the tumor. But they stapled the back of my head. And I came home. And what a ride that was. Jenny was going just straight. But for me, it looked like she was six different people. And I had the best carnival ride you could ever take because I was going all over the place. Well, anyway, I came home and I said, honey, I really want to go to church. And she said, you think you can really do that? And I said, yeah, I want to see my church family. And so went to the church and came in and everybody cheered and said, it's a miracle. And actually, I think it was a little bit of a miracle from God because I was supposed to die. Well, we went in there and some of the little children that I knew, they couldn't figure out the staples and the steel and back of my head. And I must have looked like a monster to them, like Frankenstein or something. But after that, Jenny and I went back up to go to the neurosurgeon to have the staples taken out. And the surgeon said, did anybody explain to you the pathology? And I said, yeah, it's just a simple, benign meningioma. And he said, no, I am sorry, Mr. Masterfield, but it's an aggressive cancer called hemangiopericytoma. Well, that sort of quieted my wife down on the way home and me. We didn't know what to say to each other. You know, here I made it through the surgery when they told me I was going to die, and thinking that we're going home and everything's going to be okay. But then I'm told again that I'm still going to die. That's the only time I question God. Not question God like, why did you do this to me? But question him, Lord, you brought me through the surgery only to tell me that I'm still going to die. Well, there was a reason for that, and I'll share it with you in just a little bit. We were out shopping with friends of ours, and I'm dizzy all the time. That's why I have a cane, and it's colored like this because I am partially blind. I can't see that side of my head. And so while we were out there, I got dizzier than I've ever been. I was really turning around and around in my head, and I felt the back of my head, and it felt like a water balloon back there. And so Don and Carol, my friends and Jenny's friends, and Jenny caught me, kept me from falling, and it felt like I was leaking cerebral spinal fluid. And so they scheduled me for a third surgery on my head. And what had happened is the skull cap came loose. And so he said, no problem. I gave it to the same physician that had the surgery fail because I didn't want him to feel bad doing a second surgery on me. So he came in. And he said, this shouldn't be bad. It should be quick and easy. And so not life-threatening because he's just putting the cap back on. So he came in and he pinned it, screwed it, whatever he did. But he said, Jim, you could take a sledgehammer to your head and it's not going to come loose. So I thought, what an awesome God you are, Lord, for doing this, getting me through everything. And as I was praying to him, I was praying, Lord, thank you. Thank you for doing everything that you have done for me, getting my attention that I can come to you closer now and have you as my Lord instead of just as my Savior. Well, little did I know remember when I told you I didn't know what my testimony was going to be? Well, two nurses came in, and they were reading my chart. And as they were reading my chart, I could tell they were going, looking down and looking sad, sort of. And they finally, one of them said, "Oh, Mr. Masterfield, we're really sorry what you've had to go through and what the prognosis is." And I finally found the testimony that God gave me. He gave me a testimony that I could share with everybody. You know, when they came in, I could share Christ with them and have it be meant for them. I mean, I could look at them and share Jesus Christ, and they knew the sincerity of my heart because of the position that I was in. So, a negative affirmity? No. It's been the best thing that's ever happened to me in life. It gave me a testimony that no one could refute. So, I started going around to different churches, and I started giving my testimony. And the Lord, whenever, you know, he's not looking for ability. He's looking for availability. And I told myself and prayed about it and said, Lord, open the doors for me. And he has not quit since. He still keeps opening doors. And I've gone to Russia with I can't remember what the name of the group was, but I flew to Russia with them, and in 10 days, they had me speaking at 10 different groups. And as far as interpreting, they spoke great. I knew them personally because of one of the guys I knew from our church. It was his kids that were over there. And so Lance, the person that interpreted for me, he took me everywhere in Russia. I didn't sit still for one day. I went all over Russia, and one of the places was a orphanage. And at the orphanage, I was given my testimony, and a lady who couldn't speak English, just Russian, she started weeping, and I couldn't figure out what happened, but she started crying profusely and ran out, fell down on the threshold, and went away, and no one knew what happened. And Lance, who was interpreting for me, she was crying because she just found out that she has cancer. And so when she came back in, she just bolted to me and about knocked me over, and she just gave me the biggest bear hug and was just squeezing onto me. And so I was interpreting, my interpreter was interpreting what I was saying and what she was saying. And it was like that for the 10 days. we went all over the place. And then again, when the church that I go to in Brownsville, Oregon, they paid for my wife, Jenny, and I to go to Indonesia. And so for 10 days that I was there, I spoke 17 different times and gave my testimony, once at the Senate, three times on the radio, and the Lord just uses you. He's not asking for anybody that has a perfect speaking. I don't have that. Now I can barely speak straight most of the time. And I forget things, and I have my visual things. I can't drive, so I have to be driven around. But you know what? This is the best time of my life because I'm serving the Lord God Almighty and bringing souls. He's bringing souls by using me, just a vessel that's broken. That's why I said he's not looking for ability. He's looking for availability. And so I thank God that he's allowed me to share a little bit of him. But I want to share this one other thing. Back when I was getting the third surgery and the nurses came in, right prior to them coming in, I was praying to God and thanking him for all the blessings. And it has been the biggest blessing that I've ever had because I have gotten so close to the Lord. And if you want a relationship with anybody, what's it take to have a relationship? Time, right? Well, the Lord is no different. You know, if we're going to have a relationship with the Lord, we need to have to spend time with him. Otherwise, he's going to say, when you get up there, I don't know you. And I don't want anybody to have to walk away because the Lord Jesus Christ said, I don't know you. Anyway, getting back to that, while I was praying, I was thanking the Lord for all the blessings that he has given me. And I thought, Lord, I am sorry. I tend to just thank you and give you acknowledgement when you bless me for things that I've asked for or that you've done for me. And I don't tend to just praise you and give you glory and honor just because you're Almighty God. And when I said that, he did something to me that I can't explain to you. Take it for what it is. But at that moment, when I said that, that you're just Almighty God and we need to worship him, not for what he does for us, but just because he's Almighty God. Well, he gave me a little piece of himself. He came to me and I can't describe it. I didn't see anything. I didn't hear anything. But I could feel his presence within my body, within me. It was the closest thing that I ever had with the Lord, ever. And I know one thing. I don't ever want to lose it. I don't ever want to even get a little distant to it. I want the Lord to be with me for all eternity. And time is getting short. I think we're going to have the Lord come down someday. I think ever since Israel became a nation in one day, said that generation will not pass away. Well, you know what? For all of us and all the children, all of us that have accepted him as Lord and Savior, we're all going to be there with him. What a glorious time we're going to have. Well, I thank you very, very much for allowing me to share my testimony. Any questions on anything? Anything that I know there was one lady in this time before who actually had, a car accident, and she had some deficits, and she has a testimony. I don't think you have to have a tumor or be in a wreck or anything to share your testimony. We all have testimonies. We all can share the gospel.
Amen. This is Jenny, his wife. What a privilege to have him here today. Amen. He was 5 years ago, he was given 5 years to live. And I am so glad that I got to meet you, because you impacted my life. I want to read this scripture, and then we're going to pray for you too. And it says, go ahead.
Can I share one thing?
Yeah.
I don't know what God's purpose is, but I think one of the greatest purposes he could ever bestow on me, I've found out that I have three more tumors. And that's okay, because I have a longer period of time to share my testimony. I'm not afraid to be going home to him. I look forward to it, and Jenny knows that. I don't want to leave her. I have a new grandbaby. For the first time, I have a little tiny grandbaby. It's about the same as Aaron's.
They were in the hospital at the same time.
Yeah. I just thank you for letting me to be here and share my testimony.
Amen. 2 Corinthians 5. 1 says this: "For we know that if our earthly house, this tent, is destroyed, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in heaven. For in this we groan earnestly, desiring to be clothed with our habitation, which is from heaven. If indeed, having been clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we who are in this tent groan, being burdened, not because we want to be unclothed, but further clothed, our mortality may be swallowed up by life. Now he who has prepared us for this very thing is God, who also has given us the Spirit as a guarantee. So we are always confident, knowing that while we are at home in the body, we are absent from the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. We are confident, yes, well pleased. Rather, to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord." Folks, I don't give up hope for healing for Jim or anyone else, because I know that God is able. This is nothing to God. But what I do know is this: when our focus is on today and the things of today and not on God,
When our focus is on what's going to happen tomorrow and we worry and worry and worry about tomorrow, when our focus is on what we have and we wear and our health and our prosperity and our, then we're not seeking first the kingdom of God and letting Him add these things to our lives as He finds fit. Jim, by his own admission, he was adding muscle. He was adding fame. He was playing to his own ego what was good for him and made him feel good. And he cared very little about everybody else. Not a horrible person. Good, honest, go to church kind of guy. But guess what? He didn't seek first the kingdom of God. Where are you at today? I'm going to pray for Jim, and then I'm going to pray for you. Because ultimately, we don't want to repeat the same mistakes. And one thing we do want to learn from Jim is that no matter if we live or we die, we want to belong to Him. And we want Him to be the Lord of our lives. Lord, I pray for Jenny first. I know her love for her husband and her family. Strengthen her. Lord, I pray for Jim. Lord, this life is just a vapor. It comes and it goes. But Lord, we call forth the will of God and the healing power of God. The Lord, when his life is over, it'll be because you say it, not because of cancer or anything else. So Lord, I speak forth the life of God and I ask for, Lord, a miracle. But Lord, the greatest miracle of all is already finished. For the greatest miracle of all is that he has come to know you. And you are now, Lord, the Lord of his life. He is now crucified with you. And Lord, you can live through him. Lord, this life doesn't end when we die. We just move into eternity. And so, Lord, even as Jim hugged me today and said, it doesn't matter if I live or die. Because we'll be in eternity together forever. Lord, let us all live like today. Lord, we want to do your will, and tomorrow will take care of itself. Lord, I just thank you for what he's ministered today. Let the word of God bring forth fruit in our lives. We thank you. So I ask you, I ask you, are you living by your passion and your ego for yourself? I said, Jim, you know, what can I do for you if you're going to come and take your time and speak? And what can I do for you? It's funny, you know, every speaker gives me the lecture on, you know, well, I got a lot of expenses and I got a lot of this and I got a lot of that. Jim said, well, I don't really need anything. I just don't plan on being here that much longer. I just want an opportunity to share what God's done for me. Man, if we all just had that, that all that matters is I just want to share what God's done for me. So I just want to ask you here right now today, we invest in us so much. But what about this morning making God the Lord of your life? What about this morning saying, I'm not so worried about me, God. Really, all I need is you. And I want you to teach me to love others and to give of myself. Not to put Jim down at all, but Jim doesn't have any hope outside of God. And neither do we just don't know it yet. See, Jim's terminal, and so are we. We just don't realize it yet. So I want to ask this simple question. If you're here and you do not know the Lord Jesus as your Savior, but this morning you would like to accept Him, the Bible says you can believe in your heart, but you have to also confess with your mouth, be unashamed of Him. Jesus hung naked and exposed on a cross. Are you willing to stand and say, I need Jesus? I want a new day. I want to start fresh and have a new day today. I want to ask Jesus into my heart. If that's you and you're going to let eternity for you begin today, an eternity with God will begin today. If that's you and you want to make him the Lord of your life, you'd like to accept him with every eye opened and no heads bowed. Is there anyone here that would just willing to stand up and say, I need Jesus so we can pray for you? Don't worry about what anyone else thinks because eventually it doesn't matter. Amen. Is there anyone else that would want to join him and just say me? I just want Jesus in my life. I don't care who knows it. I don't care what anyone thinks. I just want God in my life. I want to make him the Lord of my life. Anyone else? I'm going to ask some other group to join him. You know what group that is? It's the ones of us that are so concerned about us and what people think. And maybe we know Jesus and maybe we don't, but we've been going to church a long time. But God isn't as precious to us as we hear in Jim's voice. And we say, I'd like to rededicate my heart to the Lord. I'd like to make sure that he's that precious to me. You may be a pastor here and stand for that. But would you join those that are standing right now, if that's you, and say, I want that passion in my heart. I want to know him who is life eternal. Amen. Just feel free to join us. Not going to embarrass anybody. We're just going to pray for each other. Amen. Just bow your heads and close your eyes. Lord, I pray for each and every one that has the boldness to stand. Lord, whether they're committing their life to you for the first time, or Lord, whether they've committed their lives many times, God, I ask that today be a new day. That, Lord, we would not be sad over what Jim has told us, but Lord, we would be challenged to let you be the Lord of our lives, to be able to not let all the petty things in life get us down, when Lord, there's so much you've given us. Lord, let us do and appreciate what you've given us and use what you've given us to bring you glory.
I hope that in watching today's testimony from Jim, for many of you, you may be looking at the end of your life, and many of you may have a terminal illness, or maybe you just realize that all of us are terminal. All of us need Jesus Christ as our Savior. I hope that this message today has impacted your life. Jim is an amazing man with an incredible outlook on life that he has received by an encounter with Jesus Christ. Same encounter you can have, the same truth that you can know, the same God who wants to work in your life. You may say, well he's going to die. Well, if death is not the end, but just the beginning of eternity, then you can handle death. For you, I want to ask, just as bluntly as I can, if you were to die today, where would your life be? Where would you be? Would you be dead like a dog? Would you be in a new horizon? Or would you be in the hands of God? I want to tell you, no matter how good and how many wonderful good acts you do, you can't earn the right for eternity. You can't annihilate all of your sins. But one thing you can do is trust the Lord Jesus Christ in his shed blood on the cross of Calvary so that your sins can be forgiven. He paid the price. I was in a counseling session where there's two people arguing over who owed who money. Finally came down to one saying, I didn't owe you anything. The other one said, I think you owe me $600. And I looked at him, knowing that this was coming up. I had pulled $600 out of my savings account. I sat there across from them and I took the $600 and I said, on behalf of you, you owing this money, I gave them $600. And they said, you can't do that. The one that I paid the price for began to weep. And she said, I can't pay that back. And I said, I know that. And so your debt's been paid, and now you're forgiven. And they said, how could you do that, Pastor? And I said, because it's probably the greatest illustration of who and what Jesus has done for us. He's paid our debt. Doesn't matter what anyone thinks or anyone says. Doesn't matter how much we think we owe or we don't owe. All that matters is this: as we trust in Christ and we accept his forgiveness, he paid our debt, that instead of receiving death, we could receive eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Today, receive not money, not what somebody can do or do for you, not do for you. Today, receive the forgiveness of Jesus Christ. There's people that are on the phone lines. They would love to pray with you. They'd love to talk with you. They'd love to help you as you come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, who he is, and what he wants to do in your life. Thank you for watching today's message. I pray that if this has impacted you, that you'll go right to the phone and call or go to our website. We'd love to hear from you. We'd love to know what God is doing in your life. And I also want to end by saying thank you to all you that make this ministry possible by supporting us, by praying for us, by helping us. You know, it takes finances to do this, and so many are faithful there. It takes spiritual prayer warriors, and those that are faithful in finances are also usually faithful in praying. Thank you for the do what you can. And thank you for making it possible that we could take the gospel of Jesus Christ. Testimonies like Jim's and many others, the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ through the sermons and messages to a place that people are, right where they are, what they need. Not a bunch of religion, but a clear, methodical at times, but clear message of who Jesus is. Thank you.
Crossfire World Outreach Ministries is supported by faithful monthly contributions from viewers like you. Please take time today to make your tax-deductible gift to Crossfire World Outreach Ministries, 942 28th Street, Springfield, Oregon, 97477.